Good afternoon, children. Yes, in the last class, actually, we were already started the discussion with respect to the first chapter, that is nothing but the living word. In that one, we were already discussed the few things about the chapter. So what is the life living, the characteristics of the living organisms, etc., isn't it? In this class, we will continue the discussion with respect to the diversity in the living world. Okay, so let's start the discussion with respect to the diversity in the living world. First of all, you know, I told you in the last class also, the biology is the study of living organisms and their processes, isn't it? And the planet Earth, that is nothing but the planet of our Earth, has various kinds of living organisms comprising prokaryotes, eukaryotes, unicellular, multicellular, plants and animals. Okay, and which is called biodiversity. Are you getting what I'm telling? Yes. Hence, the world is having such a wide variety of the living organisms. So that in briefly we can say, how can you define the biodiversity? Means it can be defined as the variety and variability among the living organisms, or there is another definition, the sum total of species richness is also called biodiversity. Okay, and in the simplest form of the definition, the number and types of organisms present on the earth referred to as, that is nothing but biodiversity. Okay, so this is we should know, because there are various type of the organism which is present on the earth. For example, till now whatever we know about our earth, the number of species is described, that means it's about 1.7 to 1.8 millions. Okay, so that means it's about 17 to 18 lakhs of the species were described. Okay, and there are still millions of the species are till now it is not discovered. So that means every day, so there are different type of the the parts of the world with respect to the various scientists, they are discovering every day. Okay, a few species of the new species with respect to plants and animals. That one we should know, and we should aware about all those things. And here, when it comes to the, the biodiversity, how we will study all these things? As I said, there are millions of plants and animal species are present in the world. And we know about them by their local names or languages. Okay, but as we know, these local names or languages would vary from place to another, that is from place to another place, even within a country or a state. Probably it would lead to a lot of confusion in identifying such organisms. Hence, there is a need to standardize the naming of living organism in such a way that a particular organism is known to all by the same name all over the world, which is called nomenclature. Okay, and where we study about all these things, we will study all about these things under the taxonomy. Okay, I told you in the, while we are discussing about the introductory biology, I told you the meaning. Just recall the definition for a taxonomy. It is a study of identification, classification, and nomenclature of organisms. Okay. So what we will do, actually, when it is begin. Okay. So actually, the taxonomy, it is begin in the earlier ages only. So that means it is derived from the terminology, the systematics. In Latin, systema means systematic arrangement. which deals with the evolutionary relationship between organisms. Okay, so hence the biologists have established the procedure to assign the scientific name to living organism, which is acceptable all over the world, based on principles and criteria which are provided by. Okay, so you know, you must have heard about, there is a name of the scientist, the Carolus Linnaeus, one who written, that is a Systema Naturae, is the book. It is written by Carolus Linnaeus. Okay, so in that one, so I mean, as I was telling about the how the systematics was derived from, so that Systema Naturae is a book written by Linnaeus, one who is also called the father of taxonomy. That was the beginning of the classifications. And when it comes to the diversity in the living organism, what are the basic process of the taxonomy? Okay, so I told you how actually the taxonomy begins. Just now I told you, so I mean, whatever the organisms which is present on the earth, the based on the internal and external structures, the structure of the cell, developmental process, evolutionary relationships and characteristics, living organisms are classified into different taxa, isn't it? So this process is called taxonomy, and as I said, it is also known as systematics. And the word systematics is derived from Latin word systema. So that's what I just now told you, which means the systematic arrangement of organisms. The Carolus Linnaeus used the Systema Naturae as the title of his publication also. Okay, so and this basic process of the taxonomy, how it will be. So there are four steps which is included or which is considered under the taxonomy, or we can also say the basic process of the taxonomy. So that is nothing but characterization, then identification, later classification, and finally nomenclature. Okay, so let us discuss one by one. First of all, what is meaning of characterization? So whenever you see any organisms, we have to understand. So that means we have to, how we will understand? So understanding of characters of organisms, such as external and internal structures, and also the structure of the cell, development process, ecological information. So on the basis of that, we will categorize. Okay, so that's whatever we see, the external and internal structures, so those will be considered as the characterization. Okay, so based on that only, we will note the characteristics of that particular organisms also, either it may be plant or animal. Okay, yeah, the next one is, the next process is nothing but identification. Whenever we come to know about the characterization of the particular plant and animal, the based on that one we will identify. Okay, so that is nothing but it is a correct description of the organism, so that the naming is possible. Okay, so that's why I told in the beginning also, what is the science? So that means, how can you define the science? The systematic study of knowledge, isn't it? By giving evidences practically. Do you remember that one? Yeah, I told in the beginning classes. Fine, so there's a second step, identification. The next step is the classification. After the characterization and identification, it is very important how you will classify. So it is a grouping of organisms into convenient categories. So that's what we call taxa. So on what basis you will classify? Based on characters. Okay, so that classification is a process where the organisms are grouped into convenient categories based on the some easily observable characters. And to study about all the living organisms, a necessary device is required, and it is called classification. Hence, the scientific term for each category or step or rank is called taxon, and many such categories are called taxa. Are you getting what I'm telling? Yeah. And the next one, so after the final, the basic process of the taxonomy, so that means the beginning from characterization, identification, classification, the last, the process of the taxonomy, the nomenclature, how you will name. Okay, so it is a standardization of the names of organisms such that an organism is known by the same name all over the world. Okay, so I was telling about in the beginning of this class only, it is very important. So that is the nomenclature, because there are millions of plants and animal species which is present in the world, and we know about them by their local names or languages. For example, you know, onion is generally we use the term in the English, but in Telugu what we call as a eragada, in Kannada yeruli, isn't it? Like that, the names will be differ with respect to the local languages, but as we know, these local names or languages would vary from place to place, even within a country or within a state. Probably it would lead to a lot of confusion in identifying such organisms. Hence, there is a need to standardize the naming of living organisms in such a way a particular organism is known to all by the same. That means the same name should be used all over the world, which is called nomenclature. So that, for example, the Mangifera indica, if you call Mangifera indica, so then easily throughout the world they can identify it is the name of the mango. And you know, the honeybee in zoological nomenclature, Apis indica. So then throughout the world they can identify it is the name of the bee. Okay, so this is how actually the basic process of taxonomy happens. What are those one? The characterization, identification, classification, and finally nomenclature. Yeah, I was telling about the name of the scientist. Okay, Carolus Linnaeus is the first person who introduced the system of naming with two components. It's called binomial nomenclature. Okay, so it is proposed by Linnaeus. So that means his full name is Carolus Linnaeus. Okay, yeah. And because of this, I mean the things only, the biologist accepted the binomial nomenclature. So that includes two names, such as genus name and species name. The species name is also known as specific epithet. Remember, so while we are writing, I mean the textbooks also, if it is comes epithet means it is understood that the species name. So in which the first name represents the genus and the second name represents the species. Are you getting what I'm telling? Yeah. And as I said, the diversity, okay. So how, on what basis actually? So we will classify or we will give the names. See, as I was telling about, to avoid the confusion of the local languages, the biologists have established the procedure to assign the scientific name to the living organisms, isn't it? Which is acceptable all over the world based on principles and criteria which are provided by, so that is the international code for botanical nomenclature, which is popularly called ICBN. and International Code for Zoological Nomenclature, ICZN. Okay, so hence the scientific name ensures that each organism has only one name throughout the world, so that such a name has not been used for any another organisms. Okay, yeah, so that means such a name has not been used for any other organism, then it will be unique, one and only. So the Mangifera indica is nothing but only mango, so that name should not be used for any another plant. The Panthera tigris, it is for only tiger, it cannot be used by any other organisms. Okay, see, as I was telling about the binomial nomenclature, before we are going to study about the rules of binomial nomenclature, let me to tell you once again neatly. So there are number of cases they will ask one mass question like that, what is binomial nomenclature? I hope while you are listening, please note down few points. All the points are not included in the slides. Okay, yeah, fine. So how can you define the binomial nomenclature? It is a scientific method of naming an organism by two names. So that means the first name refers to genus and the second name refers to species. Here only example, if you write the Mangifera indica, that is the botanical or biological nomenclature of the mango, in these two words, Mangifera indicates the genus and indica refers the species name. Okay, if you take an example of the Homo sapien lin, Homo means it is a genus name, sapien means it is a species name. Lin, there are number of cases we use as the authors, that is a name. Okay, so that is also known authors citations. So like that we can give number of example. For example, the Solanum tuberosum, you must have heard about the Solanum tuberosum. It is a binomial nomenclature of the potato, isn't it? And Solanum melanongena, it is commonly known as brain jewel. Panthera leo, lion. Panthera tigris, tiger. The Panthera parodus, leopard. Felis domestica, it is commonly known as a cat. Homo sapiens, you know very well that there is nothing but the biological or binomial nomenclature of the human. Okay, so but remember the binomial nomenclature, how it is useful? It is useful to avoid the confusions arised by vernacular names or common names, or we can also say vernacular names are nothing but local names. And the binomial nomenclature gives universal recognition to the individual organism, so that all the throughout the world, all the biologists or the normal people also, they can easily identify the name of the organisms. Okay, yeah. Now after this one, let us come to just discuss the rules of binomial nomenclature. So this is very important for 2 or 3 mass questions, number of cases they will ask. What are the universal rules of binomial nomenclature? Or commonly they will ask, write the or mention the rules of binomial nomenclature. In that one, the first one is, the scientific names are in Latin, are Latinized and written in the italics. When handwritten, they are underlined separately. So that means while we are writing, okay, so the scientific name should be written in italics, otherwise they should be underlined separately. But the scientific name should be generally in the Latin language, or else English term should be Latinized. So this is very important. Okay, so this is the rules of binomial nomenclature. And the next one, as I said in the beginning also, the first word is genus name, that is called generic name, and the second word is a species name, it is also known as specific epithet. Okay, yeah, And the genus name starts with always the capital letter. Remember, this is very important. The first letter of the genus name should be written in capital, and all other letters should be in the small letters. Are you getting? And finally, the last one is very important. The name of the authors or scientists who described and given the nomenclature to that particular organism should be written in the abbreviation is called author's citation. Okay, so author's citation, for example, here only it is given, Mangifera indica Linn. Linn is nothing but author's citation or author's name. Okay, are you getting? It indicates that this species was first identified or described by Linnaeus. Short form they have given Linn. Are you getting? So these are all the universal rules of binomial nomenclature or rules of binomial nomenclature. Are you getting? It's very easy and you should write in the exam solution. Fine. After this one, let us discuss the discussion with respect to the taxonomic categories. Okay. So when it comes to the taxonomic categories, first we should know what is taxon. Okay, first we should know the meaning of the taxon and taxa. I was telling about just now, the scientific term for each category or the step or a rank is called taxon. Isn't it? And the many such categories are called taxa. If they ask the one mass question, what is taxon? A taxonomic group or any rank, such a species or a family or a class is known as taxon. Are you getting? Yes. And during the classification involves the hierarchy of the steps in which each step represents a taxonomic category, or we can also say rank. Are you getting? And all the category, there is nothing but categories together constitute a taxonomic hierarchy. So this question they will ask, how can you define the taxonomic hierarchy? Then you should write the orderly placement of an organism into its respective taxon is called Linnaean hierarchy or taxonomic hierarchy. And I think you must have studied in the high school level only, isn't it? The which is the highest category comes under here, so that is nothing but kingdom, whereas lowest one is a species. Okay, and each category represents a unit of classification, so this is very important. And a group of organism occupying a particular category is called taxon. The plural form is taxa. Example, the class Mammalia is the very best example for taxon. Are you getting what I'm telling? Yes. Is it okay? Yeah, fine. So when it comes to the categories in detail about the taxonomic category with respect to taxon, by comparing with the taxonomic hierarchy in the ascending order. Ascending order from lowest to highest, descending order from highest to lowest. Okay, for example, ascending order means from beginning species to towards the kingdom is known as ascending. Descending means from the beginning of the kingdom, that is a taxonomic category, kingdom, towards the species is known as a descending order. See, I was telling about the taxon, right? So if you consider the kingdom Animalia, then the phylum will be here Chordata, the class Mammalia, order Primata, family Hominidae, genus Homo, and the species Sapiens. So this is called taxon with respect to the, so that is nothing but taxonomic category as well as taxon with respect to humans, isn't it? Yeah. See here, after this one, let us study one by one all the categories or hierarchy levels. In that one, let us discuss one by one. In that one, first one is a species. Okay, yeah. So how can you define the species? It is a group of closely related organisms capable of interbreeding to produce fertile offspring. It is the lowest category. Or in another words, a group of individual organisms with fundamental similar characters is referred to as species. Okay, for example, here only the table is given. For example, the common name for mango. What about the generic name? Mangifera. Species or specific epithet is indica. Potato, Solanum tuberosum. Nightshade, Solanum nigrum. Tomato, Solanum lycopersicum. Brinjal, Solanum melanongia. Lion, Panthera leo. What about the tiger? Panthera tigris. Leopard, Panthera pardus. Modern man, Homo sapien. Out of all these organisms, indica, tuberosum, nigrum, lycopersicum, melanongina, leo, tigris, pardus, and sapiens. So these are all considered as species or specific epithet. I hope you can understand. So that's what I said. A group of individual organisms with fundamental similar characters is referred to as species or specific epithet. Okay, fine. And the next one is, the next taxonomic category is the genus. How can you define the genus? The several closely related species are grouped under a genus. Hence, a genus is the aggregation of closely related species. Okay, so we can also say it is aggregation or aggregates of closely related species. For example, if you take an example of Solanum tuberosum, that is commonly known as a potato, Solanum melanongina, okay, so that is nothing but brinjal, tomato, Solanum lycosporcum. So out of these three, the Solanum is considered as name of the genus. Okay, or if you take another example, the lion, Panthera leo, leopard, Panthera pardus, tiger, Panthera tigris. Out of these three, the Panthera is the genus. Leo, pardus, tigris is the species. Okay. Or if you take another example, like Felis domestica, that is Felis domesticus or domesticas. And there is another example, Felis chaos. So out of these two, Felis is the genus name. Domesticus and chaos is species name. Okay, so that's why the several closely related species are grouped under a genus. Hence, a genus is aggregation of closely related species. Fine. Okay. Yeah. The next taxonomic category is a family. Okay. Now, again, the question arises, how can you define the family? The several related genera are grouped under family. Okay, so how can you define the family? The several related genera are grouped under family. For example, here also, among the plants, three different genera such as Solanum, Petunia, and Datura are placed under the same family called Solanaceae. Solanaceae is the name of the family. all these three species comes under the same, that is family. Okay, then let us take another example. Among the animals, several genera such as Panthera, that is lion, tiger and leopard, and felis, cats, are placed under the same family, Felidae. Okay, Felidae is the same family. I hope you can understand. There is no need of confusion. Fine. The next one, the next category, that is taxonomic category, is order. How can you define the order? Order is the assemblage of families which exhibit similar characters. Okay, so here it's also among plants, the families like Convolvulaceae and Solanaceae are included in the order Polymoniales based on floral characters. Okay, if you take another example, among animals, the families like Felidae, that is lion, tiger, leopard and cat, and Canidae, that is a dog, are placed under the order Carnivora. Because they are all carnivorous animals, they feed the flesh. Okay, and canine, the canines. So in the teeth, the canines are the characteristic features of the carnivora for the purpose of flesh tearing purpose. Okay, yes. And the next one is clash. How can you define the class? The several closely related orders are classified under a class. Or we can also say it is assemblage of related orders. For example, the order Primata that include animals like monkey, gorilla and gibbon, that is nothing but apes. So, and the order Carnivora, isn't it, that include animals like tiger, cat and dogs are classified under the Mammalia. Are you getting? Yes. At the same time, if you consider the order Polymoniales and order Saphenids, which is comes under the class Dicotyledonae, both are comes under the dicots. Okay, so while we are discussing about the angiosperms, I will tell you in detail about the all these things. Okay, fine. The next one is, the next taxonomic category is phylum or division. The phylum generally uses the generally in case of the animals. That means in case of animals, the close related classes are grouped under a phylum. What about in case of the plants? In case of plants, closely related classes are grouped under a division. Okay, for example, the Chordata, the phylum Chordata, phylum Arthropoda, like that we will tell during the taxonomic categories. In case of the plants, division Angiospermae, division Gymnospermae, like that uses. Okay, yeah, so here only it is mentioned, right? So I was telling about the angiosperms. So that means in angiosperms, both the classes, the cotyledon, that is dicotyledonae and monocotyledonae, both there comes under the division Angiospermae. If you take an example of the phylum Chordata, class Amphibia, class Reptilia, class Apes and class Mammalia. So these are all comes under the phylum Chordata. Okay, yeah, so that means how can you define the phylum or the division? It is assemblage of related classes. In cases the plants, the related classes are forms the division. Okay, fine. And the last one, the kingdom. That is the highest the category. So we can also say the kingdom is the highest rank in the classification. Okay, yeah. The kingdom Animalia comprising several phyla, that means the plural form of the phylum is the phyla, that includes all animals and all the kingdom planting, comprising several divisions that include all the plants. For example, if you consider the kingdom Animalia, it containing all the animals. Okay, so all the phylums, beginning from the all. If you consider it's a kingdom Plantae, means which comprising all the several divisions that include the all the plants. In other words, we can also say the assemblage of related phyla or the division, and the kingdom is the highest category. Okay, here also consider the kingdom Plantae, which is include the division Angiospermae and division Gymnospermae. Okay, not only this one, beginning from algae, bryophyte, pteridophytes, gymnosperms and angiosperms. So these are all the divisions comes under the kingdom phylum. Like that, in case of the kingdom Animalia also, all the phylums which is comes under the kingdom Animalia. Okay, so this is how, so we will discuss about the taxonomic categories. Okay, fine. So let it be. So next class we will continue with respect to the organism with their taxonomic categories. So until then, please watch this video at least twice. If possible, watch thrice also. Then only you can identify all the definition and the explanation also. While you are watching the video, please note down the points, so that whatever it is mentioned here, the slides is not I am explaining, along with extra information also I am giving, so that it will be useful for you people only. Okay, thank you. Have a nice day.